I mean, that really is, when I talk about the origin story of this new origin story in the preface, I talk about taking this one semester Black history course in my high school, and that course just blowing my mind, because I was 16 years old, and in my entire career, I didn't know that there was that much you could even learn about Black people. Because as a child, you presume if it was important, they would have taught it to us. And if they didn't teach it to us, Black people must not have had that much history that could be taught. And so, believe it or not, y'all, I was very nerdy as a child. And I would ask that teacher to give me reading to do outside of class. And one of the books he gave me, I talk about, is Lerone Bennett's Before the Mayflower. Lerone Bennett, of course, was an early model of what I hope to be, a historian and a journalist, who did historically informed journalism. And I didn't know what the title of the book meant. I assumed the title of the book was talking about Africa, the history of Black people before the Mayflower in the 1600s, because I didn't know we had been here this long. And then I discover about 30 pages in that he was actually talking about in American history, that 1619 was when another ship called the White Lion came. And we all know, every American child learns about the Mayflower, everyone. This is the time of year. Mm-hmm. Where you put on your little pilgrim hat. Some people dress up like a turkey or the people that the pilgrims took the land from. And yet no American child learned about the White Lion. And as a 16-year-old, I understood the power of that erasure. And it really helped me to think about, it's not just what we learn that tells the story, it's what we're not taught that tells the story.
My wager is that today the alternative confronting global capitalist society is communism or feudalism. The capitalist dynamics that consolidate the dominance of monopolies and finance capital, to use Lenin's definition of imperialism, these are producing a neo-feudalism of parcelized sovereignty, hierarchy and expropriation with new lords and serfs, desolate hinterlands and privileged municipalities, and widespread insecurity and catastrophism. Communism, the internationalist, universalist, and emancipatory egalitarian movement toward the abolition of private property and the abolition of the division of labor, and the construction of a society where production is based on need, this communism is the only alternative that provides a future for most of us. If we're to avoid going further down the neo-feudal path, we have to organize as communists for communism. The alternative of communism or neo-feudalism provides a heuristic for grappling with where we are and what futures we might collectively create. So I reject the idea that the big confrontation today is between democracy and fascism. This occludes the fundamental character of the economy. It prevents us from seeing why ostensibly democratic polities are turning so sharply to the right. And of course, the answer is economic. The networked technological society, what I call communicative capitalism, especially under conditions of climate change, amplifies the concentration of wealth in the few and the dispossession of the many. That is, it intensifies tendencies to feudalism.
Is what we know. Is it, do you know who we are?
Well, we've discussed the claim that the revolution was really about founding a slavocracy, and that the American Revolution was really a counter-revolution to defend slavery.
I don't think people realize just what a cruel and brutal world existed, not just for slaves, but for lots of people who were considered the mean sort or the lowly, and what it means to say that all men are created equal. the implications of that, that education is important. I mean, I think the important point to make about slavery is that it had existed for thousands of years without substantial criticism. Slavery existed in Africa, in the Middle East, in Asia, and of course in Latin America and North America. But it's the revolution that makes it a problem for the world. And the first real anti-slave movement takes place in North America. So this is what's missed by these essays in the 1619 Project. And it's a massive movement of against slavery that's unprecedented in the history of the world. So to somehow turn it around and make us into a slaveocracy, slavery is confined to the South after the revolution. And that puts them on the defensive. And they, for the first time, they have to defend the institution. Now, you also should understand that slavery is part of a whole hierarchy of dependencies. There's servitude. I mean, half the population that comes to the immigrants who come to the colonies in the 18th century, not aside from the prisoners, the convicts who were sent here, but were bonded servants. Now, servitude is not slavery, but it is a form of dependency. You sign over your life to a master for 5-7 years. You can't marry, you can't own property. You belong to that master, and he can sell you. But it's not lifetime, and it's not racially based. But it is a form of dependency. That is attacked, as all forms of servitude are attacked and eliminated. In the North, slavery is abolished legally.
What to me is one of the most important aspects of the colonial project in North America, which is the construction of whiteness. That is to say, how Irish and Scots and English and Welsh, when they cross the Atlantic, somehow their identity changes from an ethnic identity to a racial identity. That is to say, whiteness, which is obviously a kind of identity politics that's very useful in terms of welding together these Europeans across class lines to confront the fearsomeness of the indigenous and the fearsomeness of the Africans. What complicated the whiteness project in Georgia also was the fact that the Spanish had a different approach to arming Africans. They had been arming Africans since the 1500s. And this is in the context, as you know, of a religious Cold War between the so-called Catholic powers, Spain and France, and the so-called Protestant power that is Britain. And London, the Protestant power, argued that one of the reasons why the Catholic powers, such as Spain, had to rely so heavily on Africans, and this may be a religiously bigoted argument, I should warn the listeners, is because they said that so many of the men in Spain went into the priesthood that there was a deficit of manpower, so therefore they had to rely more on arming Africans. Whatever the case, they relied more on arming Africans. These armed Africans from Spanish Florida were repeatedly coming across the border and attacking Georgia and attacking South Carolina as well, which helps to give rise to something that was already in motion, which was this sort of noxious attitude towards dark-skinned people, Africans in particular.
So we are today unofficially anti-racist society. We are also today a society that has had success in cultivating diversity. We are a society where if you go look on the websites of our universities, you can find within three clicks the diversity figures of the student body at those universities. You can click for hours and you will never find the income of the students who go to those universities or the income of their families. So on the one hand, we've had this tremendous commitment to and a certain amount of success in promoting an anti-racist agenda, of which, of course, I completely approve, and promoting a cultivating diversity agenda. But during the exact same period, the last 30 years, we've had another set of social developments, and that is the U.S., which was never among the most economically equal societies in the world. 30 years ago, we were way behind, let's say, the Scandinavian countries, has in fact become much less equal than it was then. If you look at a thing called the Gini coefficient, which is one standard measure the economists have of economic inequality within a nation, you will see that we have risen by leaps and bounds. And we are long since past France and past Germany. And we have actually, I think, caught up right now with China. And if we just work a little harder, we'll soon be as unequal as Mexico.
I think post-colonial theory is a disaster, even in cultural studies and in English studies. Because even in literary theory and in cultural studies, it still tries to present a certain view of the global South, of the culture of the global South, of literature coming out of the global South. And it's racist. There's no other way to say it. When we use these fancy words, Morteza, like it essentializes the East, it's just a fancy way of saying it's racist. And that's what it is. The truth of it is, everybody who's coming out of the left recognizes it. But the problem is the left outside of the academy has been destroyed. It doesn't exist. Inside the academy, if you're in these disciplines and you make these arguments, your career is over because it's run like a mafia. So everybody on the left knows this, but it's very hard for them to say it without suffering dire consequences for their careers. There is no tradition of debate and discussion in post-colonial theory. Spivak's critique of me exemplified that. You either fall into line or you're kicked out. It's not a surprise. It's a tradition that says reasoned rationality, evidence, and argument are Western concepts and therefore imperialist concepts. So what do you have left if you can't use reasoned rationality and evidence? All you have left is power. And so you settle debates by beating people up. And that's what's happening. So in my view, it's been an intellectual disaster, top to bottom. There's an enormous, fruitful tradition of cultural inquiry that pre-exists post-colonial theory. There's a tremendous tradition of understanding the particular and the local coming out of Marxism, coming out of even liberalism. But all of it respects the universal, and it contrasts the particular from the universal. All of it respects the underlying commonalities that we have as human beings, even though we inhabit different cultures, speak different languages, and have different modes of expression. What post-colonial theory did was it divided up the world into tribes and said no one tribe can ever understand or speak to the other. How can that possibly be a progressive or fruitful line of inquiry or social engagement? It can't. Post-colonial theory was at its essence a natural product of the neoliberal era. And as we come out of neoliberalism, this theory will cease to have the hold. It'll never go away, because if you give an academic license to never look for evidence, never betoken criticism, to never have to change their mind, it's like manna from the gods. So there'll be lots of academics, especially academics from the global South, who will adopt it because they'll say, you can never understand my culture. You have to come to me. I'm the native informant. I'm the key, and you have to go through me. It's an automatic license to expertise, which every academic from a certain culture is going to embrace because it helps their career. So it'll never go away, but it won't have the hold that it once did.
For several years now, I've been struck by the mismatch between the current scale of emancipatory political engagement on the one hand and the scale of the present crisis on the other. Emancipatory engagement is plentiful and potentially powerful, to be sure. It encompasses feminism, anti-racism, and anti-imperialism, as well as movements for labor and migrant rights, for social equality and livelihood security, for democracy and ecological sustainability, for peace and human rights. But these forces are fragmented and dispersed. Disparate and uncoordinated, they neither coalesce around a shared project nor constitute a counter-hegemony. And so they are overmatched by the scale of the present crisis. It's a general crisis of our whole social order, in which multiple injustices and irrationalities converge and exacerbate one another. I need only mention planetary heating and global pandemics, ballooning precarity and inequality, declining living standards and shrunken social provision, forced migration and racialized and sexualized violence, authoritarianism and persecutory scapegoating, de-democratization and militarization, and now, right on our doorstep, war. Where is the emancipatory coalition that offers a credible response to this nexus of horribles? Where is the visionary breadth and practical heft that embodies a genuine alternative to the system that generates them? Where is the project that could go toe-to-toe against the powers that be, against corporate neoliberalism on the one hand and reactionary populism on the other? If this diagnosis is grim, I am not alone in subscribing to it. On the contrary, many social justice activists and thinkers have grown dissatisfied with single-issue identity siloed politics. Appreciating the need for greater coordination, they are now seeking larger frameworks that can connect the dispersed struggles of multiple movements, political organizations, and labor unions.
Precisely when white liberals humiliate themselves, and I notice this again and again, we are worthless, we don't have the right, that's subtle racism expressed in this forum. If you are an exotic nation, if Native Americans dance their tribal dances and so on, that's perfect. They are asserting their particular identity. If I say, let's assert German identity, you are a Nazi, you are a fascist. Okay, I know in what sense this is true. But nonetheless, there is something false in it. Why? Because denying you the right to your particular identity, in this false sense, humiliating yourself, means that in a much more subtle way, you reserve for yourself the universal position. I notice again and again how these same white liberals who are ready again and again to humiliate themselves, we are the worst, we are guilty of everything, and they like to play this game. Whenever that something horrible goes on in third world countries, it must be a consequence of colonialism, you know. Which, as a black friend that I have from Nigeria, once he exploded and said that this is the worst racism he can imagine. They treat us, he told me, like children. We are not even allowed to be evil on our own. If we are evil, it must be effect of colonialism and so on and so on. And that's why I claim white liberals love identity politics. It means minorities can have their particular identities, but we renounce our identity, but we keep this role of guardians of universality. Which is why, I wonder if this is also your experience, it's my regular experience that this same self-humiliating white liberals have no problem of correcting minorities if they perceive their position as wrong. Sorry guys, you fell into colonialist trap here, this is not the right way to talk about it, and so on and so on. So that's why my advice is the one already elaborated, I've written about this a lot, I will not repeat myself. It's the one of Malcolm X. He was a true universalist. I'm sorry if I repeat myself here. Malcolm X, it was a Hegelian stroke of a genius. He emphasized it. X doesn't mean, white people stole from us our roots. Yes, but his point is not, so let's regain our roots and look for some original tribal identity in Africa. No, he saw this being deprived of roots, X, we don't have our particular identity, as a unique chance for the black people to propose a new
universality, which will be much more authentic and radical than white people's universality, which is still a false universality. Always remember this. The true struggle is the struggle for universality. And liberals like to transform, mystify this struggle into the struggle of particular identities, where then they can play their game, you know, of your particular identity, my particular identity, let them coexist, and so on, and so on. No, the problem today is the struggle of universalities. We have traditional liberal universality, which is the universality of particular modes of life, but the problem is, how do you define the universal dimension? The problem with particular identity politics is that it never can be all of your position. Every particular identity politics implies a universal dimension of how you construct the space in which particular identities coexist.
Do you think it's a good thing that, you know, like in Minneapolis, the fact that they're rethinking the police department and you see Confederate statues being taken down, you know, what do you say to that? Like, hasn't there been some successes?
Yeah, I'd say there have been successes. I mean, I'm happy to see Confederate statues taken down. I'm in New Orleans now, and I happen to be here when the big fight over taking down the four most obnoxious statues here it reached its culmination. I've been around the statuary all my life, practically. I've hated it all my life. I've had fantasies as a kid of blowing up the Beauregard statue a couple blocks from my house. So it's good, right? But the other thing that struck me about it is that's the way that this project of removing Confederate symbols has proceeded is one that also kind of reinforces neoliberalism, because it's dependent on characterizing what prompted the emplacement of the symbols in the first place as white supremacy. And it kind of was, but it was also like a monument to an emerging and consolidating class order in the South at the end of the 19th century, right? People forget or don't know that none of this stuff went up during the Civil War, right? Or even immediately after the treasonous insurrection of 11 states or the slaveholding elites of 11 states against the US government. It all went up between the mid-1880s and World War I, right? And those were precisely the years when the Southern elites were crafting and imposing white supremacy as a limit on, you know, not just politics among Black people, but on the possibility of like any kind of interracial, working class expression from below. And the narratives that have accompanied their removal, like in this city and elsewhere, are narratives that basically reinforce triumphant neoliberalism, right? I mean, that they're symbols of a bad old time when there was racial inequality and racial subordination. And we abhor that. And now we have like the same logic of inequality and subordination, but it's not racialized in the same way. So in that sense, as Walter has put it, and as my comrade and colleague, Wibberly Leggett, like in South Carolina, pointed out to me a number of years ago, anti-racism now is doing the same work for the same kind of work for the ruling class that racism did 100 years ago.
Yeah, well, amen to that one. But I too obviously, if you're attached to the statues staying up, people say, well, we'll lose our history to take them down. That's completely empty. So let them come down. And the problem of them coming down, though, isn't even really, you know, that it's just symbolic, although to some extent it is just symbolic, but we should care about the symbols. I mean, nobody wants those horrifying symbols. And it's interesting, I don't know if it's true or not, that the military appeared to be ready to jettison Fort Bragg's name as Fort Bragg until, yeah. you know, the guy, Trump, says, no, 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 you can't do that. So between those two, you're on the side of the military. But I mean, I think in general, it's another problem. And I think, again, it's kind of a problem about liberalism. That is the sense that we're fighting over the past here. Liberalism is like deeply historicist in the kind of current moment. And then, you know, far be it from me to be the one to start attacking reparations. That's totally usually Adolph's job. But I mean, it is kind of relevant here, just in the sense that, you know, the idea that we should be thinking about our current injustices by way of rectifying past injustices seems to me a deep mistake. And what I mean by that is this, is that, I mean, well, think of reparations. So if you're born poor and Black in the US today, again, the history, it's not hard to figure out the history. We know why people are Black people are disproportionately poor. We know all that stuff. It's the slavery, it's the racism. But so reparations for that. But I mean, supposing you're born poor and white, and you're born not because obviously your great grandparents were slaves, but like your grandfather was in a union and the union was busted, or even maybe you were lucky and your dad was, and Reagan busted his union and he lost all his money and he lost his house that way. And you're poor for that reason. So like, you know, reparations, the whole concept of it is if you've got the right account, the right sort of history of, the right causal account of how you became poor, then okay, we're gonna try and do something for you. And if you don't have the right account, then it's your problem.
What have you been doing here? If it would please your majesty, we've been trying to—
I see. Off with their heads. Separate them, abbreviate them, and I'll trust you to pick up the shreds.
Don't worry, you shan't be beheaded.
Are their heads off?
Well, the heads are gone, if you please, Your Majesty.
That's fine. Do you play croquet?
Oh, yes.
Come on, then.